Good evening, everyone. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Excuse me for losing my voice a little bit. How are you? Just adjust my cameras. It's a Monday edition of the What Would Jeff Do show. Live, it's on for 1 hour from 9 to 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I do this every Monday and Wednesday night. And then every Saturday, I've got the radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Radio show, which is on from 9 to 11 a.m. at AM 790 in Providence, Rhode Island, and then it's also streamed live around the world. If you're brand new to the show, welcome. Hello, everybody on Meerkat. How are you? Thank you so much for joining me and for watching and retweeting the show. I really appreciate it. A little bit hoarse from the weekend. We had a RV dog training seminar this weekend. It was a sold-out seminar. It was wonderful. We had 15 dogs. There for 2 days, and it was life-changing. I just put up a slideshow of some photos of the weekend seminar, and some video editing will be coming up. A couple of videos did go up. We had everything from dog aggressive dogs to human aggressive dogs to separation anxiety. Just a lot of wonderful things were going on, so it was really, really great. Just adjust my... If you've got a question on you, type it into your chat box. This show is available to folks around the world live because I get anywhere from 12 to 20 emails, Facebook messages, tweets a day asking for help with their dogs. And there's no way I can possibly even begin to answer even one of them. So I offer this format of a free webinar and free radio shows to answer all your dog training questions. And if you ask me a question, it will get an answer right now. I don't have to look up the answer. I don't have to think about it. I will give you the answer right now. There's no way that you own a dog that I cannot help. The most troubling issue of a badly behaved dog, the secret to success is you actually doing the work. Doug asked a question in a recent post. You commented that it was working with an aggressive dog doing some counter conditioning food advocacy protocols. What does that mean? Great question, Doug. Doug was referring to a video that I posted up today. And what behavior modification is and counter conditioning is this. It is getting the dog to rethink on its own the way it currently thinks. It's really easy to get a dog to do what you want it to do. Getting a dog to do what you want it to do because it wants to do it is a whole nother thing. So a counter conditioning food protocol is what we do with that. So for instance, the counter conditioning food protocol that we can do with say physical touch. A dog doesn't like to be petted on the head, or a dog doesn't like to have its nails clipped. So say a dog doesn't like to have his nails clipped. And it fights, you need three people to hold the dog down. What you can do is you can do a counter conditioning food protocol where for the next 2 weeks, the only way that it's going to eat is through the process of having its nails touched, handled, dremeled down. And you start out on day one, and if you feed your dog twice a day, the only way that it will be able to eat its food. I'm not talking about treats. There's a big difference between food training and treat training. I don't do treat training, I do food training, but I also am a balance trainer, so I use a lot of, we're a remote collar company. So we have a balance of 90% positive and then 10% aversive or punishment. And I think a lot of folks don't understand what balance training truly is. So for the next 2 weeks, what you would do is you would take your nail clippers or you would take your Dremel and you'd start out by just touching the dog's nails. So touch, 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 feed the dog. A couple pieces of kibble. Touch, 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 feed the dog. Touch, 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 feed the dog. You would do that on all four paws. And then you can go to the next step, which is you can squeeze the paw, squeeze each toe, squeeze, 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 food, squeeze, 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 food. Okay, so I think you're beginning my point. Then what you would do is you would cut one nail, food, cut another nail, food. The goal is that right now, your dog, when it sees you that wants to clip its nails, will freak out. It's associating nail clipping with something terrible, something it wants to avoid. If you turn that protocol into the only way the dog is going to eat, and it will only eat when nail cutting is going on, it will then rethink its position on cutting its nails. Now when it sees the nail clippers, it will get excited because it knows it's going to eat, and it will allow you then to cut its nails. So imagine for 2 weeks, if you did that, now you've just technically rewired the dog and how it thinks about something. A meerkat, Jay says, hey Jeff, this is Jay from the webinar. I'm going to try meerkat tonight. Great thing. Hey Jay, thanks a lot. I appreciate it. Let me know how it goes. I'm just starting on meerkat. It's a live stream. You can also retweet this like right away. I think you can favorite it. You can retweet it. It goes out to all your people, which would be really great. Sammy says, hi, hello. Sammy, now's a good time to ask a question. If you've got a question, you can just type it right into the box, okay? So whoever has a question can just type it right into the text box. Make sure you mark it to admin only, so everybody doesn't need to see it. I'll be taking occasional water and coffee breaks because I'm losing my voice, all right? A couple of things I wanted to talk about while I'm waiting for some questions is there was a video that I put out on a dog that's highly leash reactive and reacts to every dog, and it's really nervous and anxious. And this was on day 4 of training. And you can see this video on last week's Facebook page. If you're not familiar with my social media, for the folks on Meerkat, that's the name of my company on Facebook, solidcaninetraining.com. And there's about 20,000 posts, probably more than that by now, 20,000 posts on there of our working kennel. We work with dogs every day, 7 days a week. It's a working kennel based in Providence, Rhode Island. And we work with some of the most dangerous dogs in the country. And also we work with, 10-week-old puppies as well. So you either spend thousands of dollars on my training or you spend a few hundred dollars on my training to prevent spending thousands of dollars on my training. It's your choice. And somebody made a comment that the dog was, its tail was tucked, ears were down, and it was panting and licking its lips. So it's nervous and stressed. Whenever I see comments like that, I sort of laugh because, number one, the dog's tail was not down, the ears were not back, the dog was not panting, and the dog was not licking its lips. So it's a canned response that people that are against the tools that we use like to write. But also, let me remind people on my videos, we work with really stressed and dangerous dogs. What should that dog look like in the video? See, this is the thing that people don't understand. That's like if I'm 300 pounds and I go to the gym and I'm down to 250 pounds and somebody shows a video of me and explaining that I'm losing weight, and then somebody goes, look at that fatty. The guy's 250 pounds and he goes to a gym. It's like, well, I used to weigh 300 pounds, you asshole. I've lost 50 pounds already. You know nothing about my prior story. So people don't know about the prior story to any, but ironically, on the videos, I explain what the prior story is, but they don't hear any of that stuff. So we've got some good questions, so might as well go into the questions. Sammy says, I saw a video with you holding a Yorkie with gloves. Why hold with gloves, and where did you get the gloves? All right, Sammy, so that was a biting Yorkie. So with biting, with small little dogs that don't like to get picked up and don't like to have their heads rubbed, what I do is I just put on welding gloves. They're welding gloves. You can get them at any home, like Home Depot or Lowe's or Harbor Freight. And I pet the Yorkie, And if it bites, I just stick my hand right in its mouth and I let it bite me. So with a lot of little dogs that bite, I just put on those gloves and I stick my hand right in their mouth if they try to bite me, and I let them bite me. And a lot of times, once a dog realizes that the biting doesn't work, it stops. So that's why I was wearing the gloves. Nancy says, does leash reactive only pertain to actions on leash? What do you call squirming when trying to put on a leash? Yes, leash reactivity is only the behavior of the dog on the leash. That's why they call it leash reactivity. And that's usually when you're walking your dog. Your dog is highly reactive to humans and dogs. So the dog explodes on the leash. It looks like an attack dog on the leash. It is at the end of the leash. It is barking. It is screaming. It is jumping around. And it is people looking at it like, oh my gosh, look at that out of control dog. That is what leash reactive is. What do I call squirming when trying to put on the leash? I call that a bratty, snotty dog. That's what I call that. That's a bratty, snotty dog. That's really easy to fix. And you just have to give that dog a quick correction, give it a little bit of a finger poke, or put a slip lead on it first, and then give it a correction. And then you want to role play putting the leash on and off. So we don't put up with that. That's bratty, snotty behavior. So that's nothing even close to leash reactivity. Taya, if I'm pronouncing your name right or wrong, I'm sorry. How often did you pack walks? I attended the one on Sunday. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. John was great. Yeah, John is incredible. And we do them usually every other week. And you can follow me on Facebook to find out about them. Everything is on Facebook. I put everything we do is on Facebook. There's an event section on Facebook that lists the pack walks, this podcast, and all my RV seminars as well around the country. I travel the country, and I'm also going up to Canada as well. I'm trying to book one in. We're trying really hard to do one in Australia and in the UK. And also, I got some interest from Singapore, which we're going to try to maybe do, because it makes sense if I do Australia that I also do Singapore at the same time. Sammy says, I'm going to try that with my Chihuahua. He's possessive of my wife and does not want to move when I tell him to move. And I do not want to be bitten. Okay, so Sammy, what you want to do with that is, first of all, if you've got a Chihuahua that doesn't want to move, I would make that dog move. So keep a leash on that dog. And if he doesn't, first of all, that dog should not be on the couch. The dog should not be on furniture. And you should start training that dog fully. When I mean fully train that dog, you can go to my YouTube channel. The YouTube channel has got over 500 videos, and I've got something called do-it-yourself dog training. And what you'll do is you will start at the beginning, and you'll start training that dog to do everything. That dog should be crated at night. That dog should be crated when you're not home. That dog should have no free roaming at all. That dog should always be in command, like the place command. The dog should not be coddled or cooed at. And that dog needs to be corrected if it's being protective of your wife. Because if that dog was a German Shepherd, Rottweiler, Doberman, or Pitbull, you have to treat it the exact same way. Because a Chihuahua is the number one, I'm sorry, Dachshund is the number one biting dog. Chihuahuas are right up at the top. So the amount of dog bites in quantity, Chihuahuas beat Pitbulls, just to give you a heads up. So let's work on that. But I would just keep a leash on that dog. That dog doesn't want to move. You make it move. Jamie says, hi, Jeff. Hello, Jamie. I have a 7-year-old Jack Russell wired-haired fox terrier mix named Scrappy. He is an anxious guy who can be aggressive and territorial. He goes crazy when someone comes to the door, has been aggressive towards my boyfriend coming into the door and cat around food. I'm wondering where to start. So where you start is this. First of all, what I just explained on to the previous question, the dog is to always be working. Okay, the dog is to always be working. That dog should have a leash on and a training collar on. 7-year-old Jack Russell should have a 2.25-millimeter prong collar on with a 6-foot leash dragging behind it. You only do this when you're home. You never leave a dog unsupervised with a leash and collar on. The dog should be That dog should be in a crate at night, in a crate when you're not home. That dog should be learning the place command. The dog should be learning how to heel properly. The dog should not be on any furniture at all. The dog should have, has to understand the concept of no. The problem is that dogs don't understand the word no. So it needs to know what the word no means. So no means don't ever do it again. So the dog should never rush the door. Dog should not be rushing doors. The dog should be in place instead. If he's anxious, the anxiety comes from lack of leadership and guidance. Also, you want to do more duration work. Obviously, yes, you want to do exercise, structured exercise, but you also want to work on duration work. So if you, I think I posted a video today of me sitting on a couch in my office doing computer work, and I had two fighting dogs next to me in place for 90 minutes doing nothing. These dogs used to fight with each other. So we don't want that to be happening. So the magic is structure. The magic is structure. So the magic to all of your dog training, most dog training issues, is massive amounts of structure. For how long? Minimum of 90 days. 90 days is nothing. You're rehabilitating your dog. And, you know, rehabilitation is, if anybody has ever struggled with anxiety, depression, or addiction, such as cocaine or heroin or pills, think about rehabilitation. Think about the length of time it takes to be rehabilitated. Well, that's what we're talking about with dogs. I associate dog rehabilitation and drug rehab very similar. And sometimes it's ugly. And we show videos of the ugly part. And that's what a lot of people struggle with. Nobody ever shows videos of the ugly part of dog training. Nobody. We do. And we get a lot of backlash from that. I'm okay with that because the people that it's helping is all that I really care about. The people that it doesn't help, I could care less. So if you don't like my videos, don't watch them. If you don't like my podcasts, don't listen to them. If you don't like what I have to say on my webinars and my Facebook, don't read them. It's funny how people want to argue about things. There's a lot of dog trainers out there. Stop paying attention to me. Start following them. Don't do what I do. Do what they tell you to do. If it works, great. If it doesn't work, try something new. So it's sort of practical, in my opinion. Sammy says, I agree, regimen change in order. Good job. Good job, Sammy. Jamie, I saw your video about the place command. I was wondering if you can have two places for the place command. Jamie, you can have as many places as you want. You can have place in different areas of your house. So every room, we've got a placemat. So you can either down your dog somewhere or place your dog somewhere. But in place, we like to do the down command as well. So right now I've got two dogs with me. I've got a dog right next to me. For the folks on Meerkat, they can see. So that's Uma. That's Angelo. And they're both in place. And then that's Girl. She's in a down. Now, they'll be here for the whole radio show doing that. And the thing is, that they just know to do that. I can't imagine my dogs not lying down in my house. So I can't imagine my dogs running around my home. I can only imagine my dogs doing something such as laying down or place or coming with me somewhere. So your house is not a place for running around, in my opinion. That's what outside is for. That's what outside is for. David, is there any training method for fireworks other than sending Logan to you on the 4th of July? Hoping it's not as bad in your building. Thanks, David. I noticed that you made a reservation. We're actually almost booked solid for the 4th of July. Well, it's too late to do anything this year, but what you're going to do is, no, it won't be that bad. It shouldn't be that bad. Let's fix this camera. It should not be that bad by us at all. We're in an industrial area. The only fireworks that we'll hear is maybe if the city's doing some fireworks. And we also play the music really loud on the 4th of July weekend. We'll play it nice and loud. We'll probably run some air conditioning units to help drown it out. And then we've got our staff that pays attention to the dogs through the night just to make sure everybody's okay. But what you can start doing for desensitizing your dog to fireworks is you can play low volume. You get a downloading of fireworks and you start playing it in the house when the dog is eating its meals, and then at a low level, and then you start increasing the level of the volume. And you can do that over about a month's period of time, and that's going to help you with your firework to desensitize the dogs to your fireworks. So you can try that. If people have questions, we want you to write them into the chat box below. The folks on Meerkat, you can also write questions as well. And I want to say welcome to all the folks on Meerkat. Thank you so much. I'm on every Monday and Wednesday from 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. and that's Eastern Standard Time. And then I do a Saturday morning radio show from 9 to 11 a.m. And that's in the Rhode Island market. That's on AM 790, but you can hear it around the world. But I'm also going to stream it live on Meerkat as well. So my radio show at the radio station will be streamed live. And that's a call-in radio show. You can call in 888-345-0790 on Saturdays. Doug says, a shelter dog was squirming as I was fitting a 2-millimeter prong collar on him with no helper. How do you put a prong collar on a moving dog? That's really, really hard to do. What I would do first, Doug, is I would get a slip lead, and I would take a slip lead and put the slip lead over the dog's head, and then you can stabilize the dog, and then I would start working on collar protocols. So you're going to train the dog that putting on the collar is a command. So collar on, collar off. And you can you'll do that by having the dog in a slip lead. So at least you can hold on to the dog with a slip lead and then start putting your prong collar on your dog. But it is very difficult to do with a squirming dog. The issue with most rescue dogs is they're out of control and they've got no impulse control. So the best thing that people can do is give these dogs impulse control. All right, great. So it's funny, somebody asked me a question. Every week we get new board and trained dogs coming in, and somebody asked me about how do you respond to somebody on the street that makes a comment about the training equipment that you're using, like a prong collar or a remote collar? And me personally, nobody's ever said anything to me publicly. Trust me, online, people say a lot of stuff about me. That's because they're pretty much just bullies and they're spineless and they're weak. But in person, when I'm out and about, no one's ever made a comment to me about any of the equipment that I use on dogs. Maybe that's because the way I present myself warrants nobody saying that to me, because they just know not to. I don't know. Sort of like how dogs know to behave when they're around me. But if someone says something to you and they're obviously saying something to make you feel bad about your dog, it doesn't warrant any response at all. Ignore it. Or if you want to, you can tell them to mind their own business. Or you can tell them to go F themselves. But I would just say, mind your own business. You know, we have 4 million, there's 4 million dogs a year being killed in this country. I really think that people that are giving you a hard time on how you train your dog should worry about the 4 million dogs that are being killed, and not the dog that's actually you're trying to keep alive. And usually the people that are criticizing you for how you're training your dog don't either own a dog or have a well-trained dog. They think they've got a well-trained dog, but they don't have a well-trained dog. Most people that say they have a well-trained dog I've seen their dogs and they're not very well trained. So I think people need to stop worrying about folks that are trying to make it work and just leave you alone. You know, this concept that prong collars and remote collars are hurting dogs is pretty much just a big PR lie. It's just a big, you know, public relations, you know, machine that's pumping out this information that says that they're bad, but they're actually not. They're actually not bad. So, you know, I pretty much, I used to argue with people about it, but then I grew up a little bit and realized that people just want to argue with you for the sake of arguing. And people have to understand also about dogs being stressed. It's funny that when somebody sees a dog pulling on a leash and barking on a leash and being leash reactive, nobody ever says, look at that stressed dog. But when a dog is laying down or in command and it's shaking a little bit and panting, people always say, wow, look at that stressed dog. Well, both dogs are stressed. The one that's lunging on the leash is just as stressed, actually probably more stressed than the one actually laying down shaking. Because the one that's lunging on the leash is taking the drugs. That's a drug for the dog. The one that's lying down shaking is trying to get off the drugs. Jamie says, I was wondering about how to deal with a dog finding and tearing paper or unmentionables. Well, Jamie, that's a good question. What I'd like to say is, how does that happen? How does your dog find things and being able to tear them up? Okay, so searching. Why would your dog be searching for something? Where's your dog? So I'm being, you know, your dog shouldn't be out of your sight. So in my world, if a dog isn't trained, it should always be in front of me, or it should be in command, or it should be in its crate. So what you're doing is, you're allowing your dog free roaming. So don't allow your dog to free roam. So whenever I hear about a dog like getting into someone's room and stealing stuff, I'm a little bit baffled. And I'm not being, you know, coming off as disrespectful. That's not my intent. It's sort of like I want people to realize that it doesn't have to be that way. So right now I've got two dogs in this room. I can easily have four dogs or six dogs in this room, and none of them would be misbehaving because they'd all be in a downstairs place. And when I'm done with this room, I'm going to kennel them up. But meanwhile, they went swimming three times. They went on a walk twice. We did some obedience work, and girl did some narcotics work today. And all my kids hung out with them, and two of them went to work with me. But they're never out of my sight. I never, ever allow a dog out of my sight unless they're in the kennel. So what I would suggest is train your dog on place or down. Make sure your dog is crated. Take your dog on proper structured walks. Definitely you can play with your dog. I mean, my dogs play fetch, and my dogs go swimming, but I never would allow a dog to wander in my home, ever, just because they can get a hold of something and die. So dogs can die by eating a sock. Dogs eating underwear and tampons and so Jamie, he finds them whenever he can. I understand that. So I understand what your dog is doing. I've trained lots of dogs. I know what your dog is doing. But what I'm saying is stop allowing your dog free roam. So don't allow your dog to roam free. So he's free in the house. That's why. That's the problem. So your dog is free in the house, but he hasn't earned the right to be free in the house. So I'd like you to crate your dog at night. I'd like you to crate your dog when you're not home. And then when you are home, I'd like your dog to be in the room with you in a command, place or down. So I want your dog to be in the same room as you, in place or down. So that's what I'd like. Brian, hi Jeff, I had a great time in Rhode Island seminar. Since then, my 15-month-old Dogo Argentino has shown a significant shift in his demeanor. Wow, cool. He's a lot less reactive with the dominant collar, except he's more sensitive to the e-collar. Is this because he's more in tune with the collar? Absolutely. 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 Brian, I'm really proud of you, buddy. I really wish you were closer. I wish you were closer. I'd work with you. We would get over this so quick. We'd get over it so quick. So the reason why the dog is more sensitive to the remote collar is this. Did you notice on the difference between day one and day two? And if everybody wants to see that, there's a video that I put up today of a Dogo Argentino. It's a white dog, human aggressive, and it's on a tie back, and I'm doing a food protocol with it. A food protocol, that's the dog we're talking about. And I had him off muzzle working with him. He's more sensitive because his energy has changed. And I really think that conversation I had with him when he went after me and I used the dominant dog collar, that was the game changer right there. That was it. And just for informational purposes, Brian, I could have gone about another 5 to 8 seconds with pressure on that, but I didn't, but I could have. So keep that in mind if you ever have to do that, all right? Good job, awesome job, awesome job. So work him now, work him and work him hard. Good, we got it. Looks like we got over the hump. I'm really proud of you, Brian. Lenise says, thank you for removing all the false beliefs I had regarding prong collars. I've ordered one, can't wait to use it. Our previous trainer had used a choke collar, and yes, I agree with you, it's horrible. Yeah, so, I mean, so many people use choke chains. I'm not against, choke chains are hard for, I don't use choke chains. Why? Because they choke dogs. But I'm not 100% against them. I think it takes a lot of skill for a dog owner to master. I think most dogs on choke chains literally are just choking themselves. Let's see. I've got a meerkat question. Thank you, meerkat. I got to get closer to my Jay Beasy. When working on place command with prong and leash, if they break command and I'm late on the correction. Okay. So I'm waiting for the second part of that, JBZ, for the second part of that question. But as far as the place command, if they break command, what you'll do, so anytime a dog breaks command, it's a three-part correction. As soon as you see the dog break, it's no. Then you walk up to the dog, pick up the leash, correct, and then depending on if they're at the learning stage or the proofing stage, you either bring them back to place or they go back on their own. So it's no consequence and then go back to what you were supposed to be doing. So no consequence, go back to what you're supposed to be doing. But if the dog is still in the learning stages of the command, you can't just take the dog back. You can't just walk out of the room for 10 minutes and expect the dog to stay there. All right, so you got to make sure you're scaling your training, right? Brian says, would this be a good time to use the fishing technique? No, the fishing technique was more for all that anxiety in the crate that we used to quiet the dog on the crate. What I would do is with your dog now, I really work hard on your walking past dogs, doing your remote collar healing. Remember, we remote collar heal. We'll work on that. Sammy says a prong collar is okay on Chihuahuas. Is there a special type of prong? You could, but I would use just a basic slip lead. But they make a prong collar for a Chihuahua. It's a 1.75 millimeter prong collar. 1.75 millimeter. They're tiny. And again, people have to remember, if you've got the mentality that prong collars harm, it's a false statement. It's an outright lie. I've trained thousands of dogs. We train them all on prongs. We train all dogs on remote. They don't harm dogs. A prong collar has been designed not to harm a dog. So everything you read about how bad they are, how they make dogs aggressive, no, they do not. They absolutely don't make dogs aggressive. Absolutely, they don't. Doree says, Jeff, we've had our 13-week puppy for a week now. He reacts to everything. He barks at everything and everything. I took him to the vet for a checkup, and she said he was fear aggressive and he should never be trusted around children. I've seen what you do. I don't believe it. So I would find another vet, Doree. Okay? I would find another vet. For your vet to make a statement about a 13-week-old dog should never be around children, that dog, that vet should stick to vet medicine and stay away from training advice, in my opinion. Your vet has no idea what he or she is talking about. Your vet has probably had no actual hands-on training experience. That vet has probably never rehabilitated a dog from start to finish. That vet probably cannot train even a dog into a basic command, let alone assess fear aggression and fix fear aggression. So people that don't know how to fix a problem shouldn't be assessing the problem. So that's why I don't like behaviorists. And the reason why I don't like behaviorists is because they're not working with actual client dogs. They actually don't have hands-on experience. They're nothing, absolutely nothing you learn in a classroom or through a study or a laboratory can ever be the same as working hands-on with hundreds, if not thousands, of dogs. So I would, if your dog is fear aggressive, I mean, not too many 13-week-old dogs are aggressive. That would be unusual if the dog was aggressive. So I would need a lot more information, probably more information than we can do on a webinar. So I would suggest that you probably either set up a Skype visit with me, or you go to one of my seminars, or you at least send me an email, okay? Jamie says, I have an e-collar for Scrappy, but when I put it on him, he cowers and acts much differently. So he was introduced to the collar wrong. I was wondering how to introduce to him differently. Okay. So Jamie, there's a video that I put on how to collar condition a dog. And what you're gonna do is you're not gonna use that collar for 2 weeks, but you're gonna put it on the collar every single day. What I want you to do is you're going to use every time that dog eats, you're going to put the collar on it. So it's a specific protocol, and then all of your training with the collar is going to be food based. So I've got a video on my YouTube channel called I think it's called Come Sit Break. It might be called Recall Sit Break. So Come Sit Break, Recall Sit Break. And what you're going to do is you're going to use food all the time with that collar. And the collar is just going to be a quick nick at the working level. The collar won't be doing anything. It's going to be the leash and the food that do everything. And the dog will just be used to wearing the collar. So the collar should be on all day. So halfway through the day, move it to the other side. But the collar should be on all day. Make sure it's on nice and snug. So that's what you're going to do. So obviously the collar was probably only used for no. It probably was never used for, you know, something positive. Okay. Lenise says, my 7-month-old German Shepherd responds to me with nipping and biting my ankle or hands when I try and put a leash on her. When she has the prong on, how do I correct that? Sorry in the beginning, but I know I'm going to have a much happier dog at home. You have to correct the dog for biting your ankles and hands and nipping at all. You can use something like a pet convincer. A pet convincer is that just all it is compressed air. You have to use some sort of aversive. So as far as an aversive, you could be anything. You can correct it with a leash, but you cannot allow that 7-month-old dog to be nipping at you. That's not acceptable at all. So it has to be done with a correction. Marie says, hi Jeff, what kind of collar leash do you use when you introduce dogs to swimming? All our dogs wear prong collars to be introduced to swimming. Why? Because it's the least invasive, most proactive, and kindest, gentlest, friendliest way to get the dog into the pool. I have two videos on my YouTube channel, one to teach a dog how to swim in an in-ground pool, and one to teach a dog on an above-ground pool. I teach dogs how to swim one way, and I've done it with hundreds of dogs, and it works within 5 minutes on every single dog. Okay, so one way, a above ground pool, in ground pool, hundreds of dogs, works in 5 minutes or less. So you can try your own way, but do it the way that I show you. Why? Because it works. This past weekend, I had a guest, a couple stay up at my house, and they had a dog. We did it with that dog. I do it the same with every single dogs. Every single dogs. Okay. Steve said, Jeff, I just added a 9-month-old, very large female shepherd to our home. Don't know where she came from. Daughter brought her home. Great dog, except for when she's told no, where to stop, mostly getting into garbage or food. But she's showing signs to me and my family like she will attack. I don't want to get bit. Then right after, she's the perfect dog. I'm very worried. Okay, so first of all, if you've got a dog that's a resource guarder, the way we fix resource guarding is, first of all, the dog should not be getting into the garbage. So a dog should not get into garbage. So in my world, dogs don't get into garbage. Why don't they get into garbage? Because I'm watching my dogs. So if you've got a dog that you just got, you don't know anything about that dog, and you say it's a great dog, but it attacks you. So let's clarify, it's not a great dog. So you don't have a great dog. You've got a dog that's trying to attack you. So let's concentrate on that stuff, because everything else the dog does well does not give it a free pass for attacking you. That mixes it all. Okay, a dog that attacks a human gets killed. A dog that resource guards or bites you over food or resources gets put down. So it's not a great dog. It's a dangerous dog on death row. So we have to fix it. We have to fix it now. I take it very seriously. So everything I would suggest to do, I would do with this dog in my own home around my kids. That's another thing. So if I'm rehabilitating a dog aggressive dog, I use my dogs, my own personal dogs. If I'm rehabilitating a human aggressive dog or a kid aggressive dog, I use my own kids. That's how strongly I feel about my training. Okay? So number one, you have to fully train this dog on leash. The dog has to be crated at night and at all times when you're not home. The dog needs to know basic commands. Heel, which is walk next to you at your pace. The dog needs to stop at all thresholds and sit. The dog needs to not rush through any threshold. The dog has to go into its crate on command, come out of its crate on command, not rush out of its crate. The dog should have a prong collar and a leash on it whenever it's out of its crate working. The dog needs to know the place command and a down stay. The dog should be in place or down in your home when it is out of its crate. The dog should have no free roaming ever. That doesn't mean the rest of its life. I'm talking now. We're rehabilitating the dog. Okay. The dog should learn the out command. That's what you do around a food bowl. The dog should not be getting around the trash can. That's where the problem is. So if the dog is getting into the garbage, the dog should not be getting into the garbage. If the dog goes by the garbage can, then you should use an aversive. So you should use an aversive for the dog to get by the garbage can. What's an aversive? It could be a leash correction. It could be a remote correction. 90% of the work we do with remote collars is low level, extremely positive. But I also look at corrections as positive. Yes, I look at a correction as a positive. Okay. When my child, who is in front of me right now, I've got 7 kids. When Angelo is, hey, Angelo, what's up, buddy? Just look at me. When Angelo goes by a electrical outlet and I tell him no, and he cries because I told him no, but that's a very important bit of information that I'm giving him that will save his life. I consider that a very positive, rewarding experience in his life because he will stay alive. So your dog needs to be corrected for going by the trash. But what I want you to do is not let your dog roam free in your home ever. It should always be in command. You can teach the place command in under 30 minutes. Leash on, prong on. If you don't have time to be doing training, your dog should go back in the kennel. Walking around your house is not exercise. Therefore, it should be crated. Okay? So if you go to my website, go to my YouTube channel, I've got every video to teach your dog how to fully train. Every single day, I get emails from people telling me how they train their dogs to off-leash capacity by watching my free videos. The information is there. Everything I make a video on, I do. So the same thing that people are paying $3,000 to $4,000 for at my training center is available for free. It's all there. There's no secrets. It's not magical. So Steve, you can do this, okay? But Steve, if you're having a major problem, you can also do a Skype visit with me, right? All right? David says, is it okay to use a prong collar in a 12-week-old lab? I would wait. I would do just a slip lead and then just do all food-based training right now for all the commands. You know, do the come, sit, break, do place, do sit, do down, do all that fun stuff. A lot of confidence building things, David, such as going under things, going over things, and just use all its daily food. Don't use treats, use its daily food. Jamie is an e-collar with shock and sound, and he's much more reactive to the sound rather than the shock. She's a sound kid. First of all, it's not shock. I don't like the word shock. And that's not a PR manipulative thing. It doesn't shock the dog. There's no shocking going on. It all depends on, Jamie, on what you're trying to get the dog to do. So we're not shocking dogs. Low-level remote collar training is a low-level stimulation that communicates with the dog that simulates the same amount of leash pressure. Sound, if you want to use sound, that's usually just a warning. It's a precursor to an actual correction, or it's a marker to a correction. The sound, I don't like to train on sound because what happens if the dog doesn't listen to sound? You can't increase the sound. I like to train on the remote collars on stimulation. We do everything at a low-level proactive thing. Okay. I've got videos on that as well. Ann says, timing question. On the dog I'm training was taught to bark for a treat when entering the kennel. That's annoying. Her crate skills are sloppy, working on that. I want to praise for getting crate manners right, but not for simultaneously barking. Also, I don't want to say no when crate is good, but barks. Yikes. Yeah, you can say you correct the barking. You know, getting the dog to bark in a crate and then giving it food is probably one of the stupidest things you can do. I can't imagine why somebody would want such an annoying behavior. So what I would do is I would correct it for barking. Correct it for barking. And don't give it any food. Don't give it any food for going in the crate at all. Okay. Steve, how do you train a dog you're afraid of? Really hard. Really hard. You send the dog to me. You send the dog to me. Or you muzzle the dog. You muzzle the dog. You put a muzzle on the dog. But why, if you're afraid of the dog, something is wrong. You can't be afraid of your own dog. You have to take it to a trainer. You've got to take it to a trainer and then have it trained so you're not afraid. If you're afraid of the dog, you put a muzzle on the dog. But I would start out with you keep a leash on that dog. But if you're afraid of your own dog and you can't make progress, you can't keep that dog. You can't keep the dog. Nobody should be afraid of their own dog. Nobody. But you might be afraid of the dog just because you haven't made progress with that dog. Or your dog might be one correction away from being a well-behaved dog. So I deal with dogs that try to kill humans. I deal with dogs that have killed dogs and try to kill dogs. I deal with dogs that have attacked, you know, a dozen people. Why they're still alive, I don't know. But we deal with some really nasty dogs. But everything I suggest on my show right now, we also do at our training center. So massive amounts of structure, tons of structure. So if your dog is getting into the trash and if that's when it's aggressive, don't let it near the trash ever. Keep it on a leash, keep it on a training collar. It shouldn't be in the kitchen. It shouldn't be by a trash can. It should always be in command. It should always be in command. Crate the dog when you're not home. Crate the dog at night. So if you're afraid of the dog, you know, if you've got a lot of different issues, Steve and Steve's wife, we can do a Skype visit. We can do a Skype visit. But I want you to know that your dog could be fixed. It absolutely could be fixed. Absolutely. Absolutely could be fixed. So how do you train a dog that you're afraid of? I got to tell you not to be afraid of it, but that's sort of silly. That's like saying don't be afraid of roller coasters. But you're going to have to start somewhere. You have to start somewhere. Nancy says, I'm so grateful for listening to you on remote collars. However, I've set for 7 on tap and 15 on boost, and it worked the first time. Is that unusual to use such a low number, 7? Yeah, no, it's not unusual. I would get off the boost, though. Get off the boost. Do a manual boost. What I want you to do, Nancy, is set up your set it up as M and C. So it sounds like you're probably using the e-collar technologies. So set up as M and C. So your black button is momentary, your red button is continuous, and then just do continuous. And if you have to dial up manually. So dial up manually. All right. But no, 7 is it's low level remote collar training. That's what it is. That's what you know. Remote collars are not shocking dogs. That's what people have got to understand. So absolutely, if 7 is the working level, 7 is the working level. We had a dog at the seminar that I think was on 4. Its working level was 4, okay? Lenise says, our previous trainer told me to correct the biting with a screwdriver handle and to pop her nose good enough once that she won't want to do it again. I'd run. I disagreed with that correction, so he asked if I had a large wooden spoon with a heavy handle. Do you agree with any of this? Absolutely not. No. You don't hit your dog in the face with a wooden spoon or a screwdriver handle. Absolutely not. Okay, put it this way. I don't do that. How about that? Okay? In my opinion, I don't train that way. So maybe they're very successful with that. Maybe that dog trainer is working with some really hard dogs. So military working dogs, police canines, you know, intense sport dogs. But I wouldn't do that. Even if I had one of those dogs, I wouldn't do that at all. In my opinion, why would you do that when you can remote collar train your dog? You can use a remote collar to levy a correction that's much more effective and less violent. Brian, hi Jeff. With the food protocol, does the dog have to eat out of your hand, or is it okay to use the food bowl? Food protocol training is out of your hand. Yeah, don't. I wouldn't have your dog eat out of a bowl for a long time. I would do all food protocol training, mirror it with the remote training. So watch that video, Brian, on come sit break. I think I demoed it on a couple of dogs. Come sit break, food. Do that tie back. Food handling, touch its head, food, touch its head, food. Put it on a tie back if you want to. Let's get that dog to reassociate life with awesome stuff in the remote. Steve says, when I walk in the house, she jumps all over me and grabs my arm or face, brings me down. Okay, so the dog should be crated. So Steve, this is Steve's wife. She's so big, even on a leash, I can't control her. Okay, so the dog should be in a crate. So when you come home, it can't jump on you. The dog cannot jump on you. It is impossible for a dog to jump on a human when it's crated. So what I'm telling you to do is crate the dog. Crate the dog. It is impossible for a crated dog to jump on you. You also should have a prong collar and a leash on that dog at all times. A dog should never jump. I fix dog jumping in 3 seconds. It takes me 3 seconds to fix jumping. And I've got a video on my YouTube channel, how to fix a dog. I just put it up last week. I probably put it up numerous times, but the latest dog jumping video I put up was last week. Watch that video and do what it says. It works on 100% of the dogs. This is what you do. Prong collar. It has to be a prong collar. cannot be a choke chain, cannot be a flat buckle collar, cannot be a martingale, cannot be a head harness. It has to be a prong collar. I've got a video on what size to use and how to fit the prong collar. Leash on, prong collar on. Have somebody holding the leash. You walk up to the dog. The dog walks up to you. The leash is loose. The dog goes to jump on you. The person that's holding the leash takes the leash and in a very firm downward pop, they correct the dog hard. It's not mean. It's not abusive at all. Dogs are killed in shelters for jumping. Ask any shelter staff if a dog has ever been killed for jumping. The answer is yes. If they tell you no, they're lying. So a dog should never jump on you, ever. It shouldn't jump on a child. It shouldn't jump on you, ever. It takes 3 seconds to fix. Watch that video. I do it every time. I eliminate it every time. So I can have 20 dogs on my property, and I can have Angelo, who is 2, walk onto that property. No dog would ever jump on him, ever. And they're all off leash. Dogs don't jump. They don't jump in my world. I want you to know we fix it every day. We do it every day. Do not turn your back. Do not knee the dog in the chest. Do not wait until it sits. Do not tell it to sit. Do not push it away from you. Do exactly what I said. The dog will stop jumping. Watch the video tonight. As soon as you get off this webinar, go to my YouTube channel. Watch the video. Buy a prong collar. If it's a big dog, it probably needs a 3-millimeter prong collar. Buy the prong collar, put it on, get a 6-foot leash. The dog should always be on a leash in your house. But when you come home, if you're coming home and you're the first one home, the dog should be in a crate. The dog should not be free roaming. The dog has to be crated. It has to be crated. Lenny says, good, I knew you didn't do this. It made me cry a lot because all it did would make her mad. Thank you. You're welcome. Well, yeah, Lenny, don't worry about it. It's done, right? What's done is done. That doesn't mean I don't correct dogs, Lenny. Trust me, I correct dogs. And sometimes I correct them hard. Don't get me wrong. 90% of what I do is positive, fun, praise, food-based, awesome stuff. But 10% of what I do, absolutely I'm firm. I'm absolutely firm. If a dog warrants a correction for a bad behavior and a dangerous behavior, I absolutely am firm. Steve, thank you, Steve's wife. You're welcome. I just want you to know your dog is nowhere near as bad as the dogs I see every day. And I can say that because I read the email. You emailed me today, or Steve emailed me today. I believe you live up in Buffalo, if I recall. Okay? But I want you to know your dog is nowhere near as bad as my daily dogs that I see on a daily basis, that my facility is filled with. Nowhere near. Your dog can very easily be rehabilitated, but it takes work. It takes massive structure. Remember, structure, 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 structure. Jamie says, thank you so much for the advice, Jeff. It's great having this resource available. I've got lots of work to do. Awesome, Jamie. Thank you. And I'll see you Wednesday. Give me progress. They've already contacted him. It's not in the budget. I referred them to them. Yep, I referred. How do you stop a puppy from biting at your legs or pants? I tried poking him, and I also shake a can with coins in it, but he thinks the biting is a game. So the dog thinks the biting is a game. Correct the dog. Teach the dog it's not a game. Okay? Teach the dog it is not a game. So you've got to give the dog a punishment or an aversive that will get the dog to stop. So that's what you need to do. So what's it gonna take? How old's the dog? How old's the puppy? Everyone's got a different definition of what a puppy is. Jeff in California. Hey, Jeff, working with a dog that has anxiety, nervous issues, did well with the prong dance walk, consistently wants to be within inches of the human, put it in a tie back to create an environment where I move around it, doesn't get to control space or have free access to me. Yep. Also, the place command, long duration place command. Big shout out to the folks on Meerkat. How are you? Sorry, I've been ignoring you. I want you to know, everybody on Meerkat, you mean a lot to me. This is my third Meerkat episode, but I've been doing my radio show for 6 years now. I've been doing these podcasts for about 1 year. And you can actually go to my YouTube channel, and you can see all of my radio shows archived. And I've got over 20,000 posts on my Facebook page, over 1,000 videos. I'm a real-world dog trainer traveling the country. I'm training dogs. You can go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com, to see my seminar schedule. 13 weeks old, yep. Dog's going to do it. You got the puppy. So what I would do is I would, a dog that's doing that, I would just take your thumb, stick it down his throat. Okay? So the dog's biting your pants. You can grab it by the scruff, pick it up by the scruff, take your finger, stick it down its mouth, push down, make it gag. Okay? But also, your dog might need more sleep. You should also keep a leash on the dog. So all the puppies that I work with have, every dog that I work with has a leash on. But if I'm raising a puppy, that dog has a leash on it. So at 13 weeks old, you can teach that dog, the dog's capable of learning the place command. That dog is capable of learning, you know, to go to a spot. So the dog, if it's constantly nipping you, it probably needs some rest, or you have to correct the behavior once. Steve, what do you do when our dog confronts us, when she goes into attack mode, when she's near food, aka showing her teeth and growling? Do we back off or stand our ground? You definitely don't back off. But the question is, how is your dog getting near food? You know, so Steve, how is the dog getting to food? That's the real question. How is your dog getting access to food? So the only food your dog should have access to is its dog food. And what you can do is you can do a dog training protocol where they only eat when they work. So all food comes out of your hand by doing commands. So all food, the only time they get food is from your hands through training, though. So it'll be like, you know, sit, good, food, down, food, place, food. So, Doris, you're welcome. But you definitely don't want to back off, or you're going to train an aggressive dog. But you need to have a leash and a leash and a prong collar on that dog, and you've got to take back control of your house. That dog should not be around food at all. The dog should go, when we make dinner, she can reach the counter and wants to get it. Okay, again, Steve, the dog should not be in the kitchen around food. Keep the dog away from food. The dog should be crated. If you can't watch the dog, it should be crated. Or the dog should be in place. So she should not be able to reach the counter. No dog should ever be close to a kitchen counter, ever. Keep the dog away from the counter. Crate the dog. So if you have to, when you're making your meals, crate the dog. Do not let this dog free roam. It sounds like you're letting the dog free roam and you're not crating your dog. So do not allow the dog to free roam. So therefore, that eliminates your problem. But train the place command. I've got a video on the place command. So teach that dog place. If you have to put it on a tie back, you can put it on a tie back. But you definitely don't back away. That's how you reinforce an aggressive dog. You reinforce an aggressive dog with that. Nancy, I'm embarrassed to ask, but I have a dog who is 90 pounds and I think I'm transmitting my nervousness down the leash. Nervous because of his power. Only had him 2 weeks. He has to be neutered, so involved going to the vet a couple times. He's the squirmer, so remote, not on him. Don't be embarrassed to ask, but 90 pounds, if you got him for 2 weeks, you just got to do training. Just do training with them. But if you've got a dog that you can't handle, Nancy, you shouldn't have the dog, right? So you have a 90-pound dog. For you to have a 90-pound, if you're a nervous person with a 90-pound dog, you've got your work cut out for you. You got your work cut out for you big time. Big time. So what you've got to do is you've got to take back control. Start out, you know, slow. Start out with, you know, basic leash walks. Start with your basic obedience commands. But if you're definitely nervous, you're going to make that dog nervous, and a nervous 90-pound dog becomes a dangerous dog. Becomes a dangerous dog. Taya, hey Taya, what do you recommend to do or put on the dog's neck if it gets irritated from the remote collar? I would get a hold of e-collar technologies. E-collar technologies, they make a hypoallergenic contact point that you can use that will make the dog not so irritated. Also, they make a sensitive dog contact that they can use. Lenny says, Jeff, I wish we had found you 7 months ago, as we had to take two of our dogs to the pound. They would fight and draw blood, and one was aggressive with us. So sad. Thank you for giving us hope with our German Shepherd. I've seen all your videos in 3 days and believe any dog can be rehabilitated. Just about any dog can be rehabilitated. And don't worry about those other two dogs. You did the best you could. Don't beat yourself up about it. You did the best you could. Okay. Steve, thank you so much, Jeff. I feel that there may be hope. I'm not ready to give up. We have always had Shepherd, never had a problem. Want this to work. Thank you so much. I'll let you know how things go. Okay, good, Steve. Steve, watch my videos. Follow my advice to the T. To the T. Because if your dog came to me at my training center, this is what I would do with your dog. I want you to know, but it takes work. So you've got to take my suggestions, okay? Actually, they're not suggestions, Steve. They're a direct order. Got that? Wednesday, put it this way, Steve and Steve's wife, I've got another webinar this Wednesday at 9 p.m. You should have made progress by then. I want to know what the progress was. And I want to make sure you're crating that dog too. Make sure you crate that dog. All right? All right, guys, it's 10:08. Time for me to go. I'll be back Wednesday night. Meerkat, awesome. I love you guys. Thank you so much for tweeting, retweeting, and liking. I really appreciate it. And this show also is going to be available on YouTube tomorrow by probably 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And you'll be able to see the show. Angela, you want to say goodbye?
Yeah.
Come here. Come here. Say goodbye to everybody.
Okay.
Say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Say goodbye. Say, look at that. Say bye, Meerkat. Can you say bye, Meerkat?
Yeah.
Say bye. Bye bye. That's girl. Okay. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Bye bye. Okay. Good. All right, guys. Thank you so much. Angela was in place too. All right. Love you guys so much. I'm madly in love with you.